This is the second part of the survey of nation building in Central and Eastern Europe. In the previous part, I discussed aspects of nation building in Poland, Czech, lands, and Hungary. And now we will look at the Danubian principalities in Transylvania, which will later form Romania, and the case of the Croats, the Bosnians, and the Serbs. So let's look at the those principalities that were today are that were then on what is today the territory of Romania, right? And we talked about the fact that there were two, three principalities, and Transylvania was significantly different from the other two, Wallachia and Moldavia. Transylvania always throughout history, has been in the sphere of influence of Hungary, mixed population, Western culture, while Wallachia and Moldavia mostly under Eastern Orthodox, almost exclusively Romanians living there, well, of course, others as well, and the sphere of influence of the Ottomans and the kind of Eastern culture, right? So it still discontinues, right? So we, the Danubian principalities, meaning Wallachia and Moldova, were, kind of part of the one sphere of culture and Transylvania of the other. So we have to deal with them separately. Because they were under two different spheres of influence. The Transylvania in the 19th century, so this is 1815, right? Transylvania is part of the Austrian Empire, right? And it gets under direct rule from the Austrian Empire. Within this direct rule, the better situation, the better political position was in the hands of the Hungarians and the Germans in Transylvania. Most of the Romanians were peasants. Again, the division here, the ethnic and religious, and linguistic and religious lines of separation overlap in the sense that if you were German or Hungarian, you were Catholic or Protestant. If you spoke Romanian, you were either Eastern Orthodox, right, or Greek Catholic. And remember, Greek Catholics were those where that church that used to be Orthodox, but now, hence the name Greek, but now joined the Catholic Church in the previous century or so, right? We talked about the Union of Brest-Litovsk, so the first union that happened in Eastern Poland, which was the union of the Orthodox churches there with the Catholic Church. The same thing happened here in Transylvania as well. Now, the Eastern Orthodox, the Eastern Orthodox resented this and hated the Greek Catholics for, having made this transition, and this will continue, and it will have later effects. So and then you have Wallachia and Moldavia. So let's start with Wallachia and Moldavia. What we need to understand here is that they were under, Ottoman, sovereignty, so to speak. They were not part of the Ottoman Empire, but they were, under their control, which meant that the rulers, although they have had a tradition of indigenous rulers, by this time the rulers were basically Greeks, actually Greeks, yes, were Greeks from Istanbul, Constantinople, were sent by the Ottomans from a specific quarter in Istanbul called Fanar. And this is why, and who were employed by the Ottoman Empire, which was, Muslim, sent to rule here. These were just like administrators sent there, but not to administer to, they were sent to administer, but they did not really administer, but mostly plundered. So they were known as Fanariotes, right? Because they came from that quarter of Fanar. And they were, reputed for coming for personal profit and for being bad managers. But that's the situation. And in these countries, culturally, and politically, the two influences clashed. One was the Ottoman Empire, but not because they chose so, right? And the Greek influence through the Ottoman Empire. So the Greek cultural influence was huge at this time. And then Russia, which had become by the 18th century, 19th century, a huge power, right? Who had ambitions to control the Black Sea and the straits here and so on. So they wanted to expand their sphere of influence, and these principalities were right in the way, right? So these two things will clash, and they will have to play the two. And remember, this is a time when Poland has disappeared after being one of the most important states in the Middle Ages. It has disappeared. So they knew that this is, you know, if they want to keep a degree of statehood, of whatever degree, they had to be very careful. Because these big powers were very keen on disappearing them, right? To put it that way. Right? Another interesting thing is that, you know, talking about cultural influences is, you know, this is, there were two major sort of schools or pushes. One was towards the West, but that was, and then specifically the French model, which was the cultural model in Europe, to the French model of enlightenment and so on. It came from the Greeks, you know, through the Greek channel to a degree. And then it was the Eastern, the old ways, right? So I posted two pictures on Canvas. One is of Dimitrie Cantemir, who is a famous ruler of Moldova, before the Phanariotes, actually early 18th century. But you see that he looks like any ruler from the West. Right? Any, you know, in the UK it's undistinguishable. Maybe he's from Sweden. Right? And I posted then a picture of one of the Phanariot rulers, these sent by the Turks, by the Ottomans, who, and you see this typical Eastern dress and so on, right? And that's 150 years later. But this sort of clash between the dresses, between how they, what they wore, was reflected also in culture. You know, it's a nice cultural reflection. It's a nice reflection of these cultural battles. Like, what is the model to be followed? This will continue. Actually, it will continue throughout the area in up to the middle of the 20th century, perhaps even to today, in the sense of, we know which, today not so much because this is settled, but the question was, which way to go, right? And which way to go was, do we modernize minus, you know, some of the critics said, mindlessly, by copying the West, right? Or do we go back to our roots? So how to define this new thing, and what was this new thing? This Romanian nation. Now, understand that just like in the case of the Czechs, as I was saying, this was the era and of the, all the other peoples, and throughout Europe, this was the era of nationalisms. This was the era of invention of the modern nation. This was the era of the invention of the nation. And for most peoples, it meant an invention of the nation based on cultural aspects, because few had a continued statehood like France, where, you know, you could define a nation politically. Now, of course, in Central Eastern Europe, you have the case of Poland, Hungary, and Croatia, and the Czechs to a degree, which had a history of statehood, and for them, this politically defined nationhood was possible. I could refer to, okay, Hungarian is are those who lived within the previously existing Hungarian state, right? So I can refer to that. It's the American model, it's the French model, and so on, Canadian, and whatever. You're defined by politically. Your identity is defined politically to a degree. But it was also infused with cultural aspects. So the Hungarians not only said everybody who lives in the former state of Hungary is Hungarian, they should also speak Hungarian. Just like here, you are expected to speak English to function. So it's actually not quite only political. But the first criteria will be, okay, there was a political entity, whoever is in it should speak, is, you know, Hungarian or French. But then the state will also try to make them into Frenchmen or Hungarians or Americans to that degree. Right? You have to, willy-nilly, so to speak. But in these areas, you know, this was not really, you know, there was no historical. First of all, the name Romanian was invented now, right? So there was no historical one state, there were principalities. This is why when they were united in 1859, they were called the United Principalities. Well, duh, right? It's so obvious, right? Because that's what they were. Right? But there is the, you know, again, just like in the Czech case, you have the beginnings of, or the beginnings of a stronger current, a stronger cultural and political current to assume a distinct identity and to define a distinct identity. And this, ironically, will happen not here, actually, where they, you know, they had this. Normally, you would assume they would have the cultural space to do that, if most of these were Romanian speakers and so on. It will happen in Transylvania. Because where is it that you have to define yourself with more urgency? Is there where you meet the other, right? When the other one has defined itself, himself as something else, it pushes you to define yourself as different from him, right? If you define yourself as green in opposition to me, who I'm red, then I will be reinforcing this red identity and I will take it up, okay? There's nothing that unites as a common enemy. And there was the other thing, that Transylvania was simply more developed. That the life of the Romanians in Transylvania was better than the life of the Romanians in Moldova or Wallachia. You know, culturally, financially, you know, just generally a higher level of education, of life, but also more connected to the West. And here's the key. And again, ironically, you know, the Romanians have, for most of, you know, since the 1300s to 1200s, have been associated with the Eastern Orthodox Church, right? Churches, staying in Transylvania. But there was a union, right, of the some of these Orthodox, or part of this Orthodox Church with the Catholic Church, and they became the Greek Catholic. Well, becoming Greek Catholic meant that you were still practiced some of the ritual rites of the R-I-T-E-S, of the Orthodox Church, but recognized that we're part of the Catholic Church. But it also meant that the center of your church was now Rome, where is the center of the Catholic Church. And guess what? Priests, the clergy people who studied theology in the Greek Catholic Church in Transylvania, who were, you know, speakers of Romanian. Again, well, if you were cultivated here, you spoke Slavonic or Greek. If you're cultivated here, you speak, you know, Latin or maybe German or maybe Hungarian or whatever. Right? But they go to Rome and study, and in Rome, guess what they discover? They discover Roman culture, and they discover monuments, and they discover Italian language, and they study Latin, and they see very clearly that Romanian is closely related to Latin, and it comes from Latin. And this is not like a very distant, like fuzzy notion. It is actually very close to Latin, just like it is very close to Italian, both of them coming from Latin. Oh, so much so that it's very easy, you know, I mean, it's relatively very easy to learn Italian once you know Romanian. It's a word common, very similar, I mean, the words are not far away, and pronunciation is, you know, it's still different languages, but, you know, very closely related, very closely related. And they discover this, and they come back with this huge weapon that says, wait a minute, we are ancestry, we come from, clearly we come somehow from Rome. I mean, from the Roman Empire. Remember, the Romans were here, we talked about the Dacians and the Romans. And this is the origin of this myth, and I'm saying myth as a story of origins, not necessarily untrue or not necessarily true, right? It is this narrative about the past that you use in order to define yourself today, right? So you create this sort of a myth of origin, as if, you know, again, the past was destined to end up somehow. It has a historical basis, actually, right? It's very obvious. You go to Rome, you see the famous column of Trajan that I mentioned, right? Where you see depicted the Dacians. And then there's this whole thing that the Dacians and the Romans just mixed up and came the Romanians, right? That's obviously a very simplified view, but it's catchy. Right? And clearly, their language comes from Latin, and clearly there's that history and so on. So, but you don't have a solid grasp, and again, you need, it's a narrative. So they come back and say, wait a minute, we go back to Romans and other peoples who were here, Dacians, whatever. So actually we precede whoever other populations are here. And again, this becomes important when the language you speak becomes important politically. Before, it wasn't really. Although you always had this sort of, you know, you had the tensions, Czechs and Germans, Czech speakers and Germans, or Bohemians and Germans, and, you know. But again, the cultivated language was either German or Latin or Greek or whatever it was, you know. And the peasants couldn't write and read, so, you know, it was irrelevant what language dialects they spoke. But they come back and say, wait a minute, you Hungarians, and wait a minute, you Germans, who define yourself linguistically and also claim, based on that you're a political nation, and based on that you claim self-governance. That's the key here. That in the modern state, in the age of the modern state, you know, of nationalism, and of the sort of rights and individual rights of the peoples to govern themselves, the key becomes who defines himself as a nation and who gets to claim first and exclusively the right to govern themselves. Right? In this continent where we are today, it was those few British, 13 British colonies that claimed the right to govern themselves you know, over populations who pre-existed here and who are still there, but those are completely ignored. So the question is, who gets to claim this in the name of what? First, and who gets to impose this claim on the others? For various reasons. More resources and whatever. So these Romanians, at this point, were finding themselves without political franchise, now come with a strong argument saying, wait, we precede you. We precede you, so actually we have a pre-existing claim to nationhood, which never, you know, never had that concept, or that was never was efficient or interesting politically or of any effect. But now you come with that. That's a huge weapon. And that becomes the beginning. Remember, in Transylvania, which was a mix, just like in many other parts of the region, of many ethnic groups and religions and so on. And now you have three competing groups saying, no, it's me. Now, the advantaged ones were actually the Hungarians, because they have been part of the Hungarian state. And after the clashes between the Hungarians here and the Austrian crown, into this region, although initially ruled directly by Austria, will become part of Hungary. And now you remember what we talked about when we talked about Hungary, their policies of Magyarization, of making, you know, of incorporating all the population, no matter what language they spoke, into the Hungarian state, but also making them speak Hungarian, just like the Maria Theresa Joseph in the 1800s, early 1800s, late 1700s, try to both centralize power and also Germanize, right? And you always had the backlash, and here you have the same backlash. So a lot of the grievances and the tension between, you know, Romanians and Hungarians, which actually even characterize relationships up to today, come from, you know, these competing readings of history, and especially here in Transylvania. Because remember, Transylvania had been, after the Turkish occupation, the hotbed of Hungarian culture. And the only Hungarian, you know, principality that was free, and Hungarian dominated. But numerically, actually, at this point, early 1800s, you know, those who speak Romanians, although of lower class, were in majority in this land, maybe two-thirds of the land, right? So, but initially they didn't want, you know, the point was, let's all have, you know, the same political rights. But the problem becomes if you, who has priority, whose land is this? Well, you know, probably the most efficient would have been to be a land of many, but not in the age of nationalism, when these claims are exclusive. These claims are exclusive, right? You know, just like, in the, again, I'm giving you examples from the US history or history you're familiar with, because you have to understand these are processes that happen everywhere. It's not some extraordinary, you know, crazy people. Right? Think of the Civil War, and I mentioned the Civil War, and again, remove the slavery from the discussion, although it was a significant issue of the cause, right, of the Civil War, but it was, the arguments were about, you know, a good number of the arguments, and then another aspect of the thing was a question of nationhood and nation building, in which, you know, in 1812, the government of the United States tried to invade Canada, before 1812, saying, well, here's, you know, we can take them immediately. That was the senators, that's what they were saying. Just give me my militia, and in one day I'm going to conquer Canada. It was just another leftover colony. Why wouldn't they? Why, it was the 14th colony, so to speak, right? But they failed. And hence today we have Canada. They are English speakers, aren't they? But it failed to incorporate Canada because of a failure of military action. 50 years later, as a result actually of that defeat, the United States developed a standing army which it didn't have, with resources and preparation and so on. So when the time came for some of these states, provinces to try to separate, it had the tools to conquer them and to impose one nationhood, one statehood. You see how sometimes these things happen because of accidents. Just like with, you know, these colonies becoming separated from the British. If the British would have won, they wouldn't have separated. So that's simple. Well, they were all British at that point, right? They were British colonies, right? But it wouldn't have had a new state. So you see how, you know, I mean, this is the process. The process that goes on exactly at the same time throughout the world. And it has to do with the rise of a modern state and and this definition of nationhood, because, you know, as an important linchpin between the idea of people's rights, democracy, and centralized rule, which is the modern state. When you connect the fact that the people needs to run themselves, right, and that's the essence of the modern state, people governing themselves, the point is, which people? Because, again, the world is not made of neatly separated, you know, entities, and who better to know this than, you know, us here in the United States, where actually it's a nation of, it's a country made of colonists and continued immigration. So, these members, famously of the Transylvanian school, emphasize that language, emphasize the Latin origin, and create this narrative of ancient origins that go back to the Dacians and the Romans, although there are all those centuries where it's not clear what happened, who was there, because there are no documents, 4, 5, 6 centuries. And the first states, again, remember, were formed only in the 1200s, and under, you know, so, you know, politically, there is preeminence of, you know, this state here, rather, right? But, again, if the definition is linguistic, then, well, this precedes the political reality, you know, Romanians have been here because, linguistically, you know, we can define them back to the Dacians, right? Or whatever, the Romans. So that's the clash, right? And it, because they failed to gain political advantages in Transylvania, again, accidents of history, these Romanian speakers here become increasingly allied with Romanian speakers here, although very different culture. You see, we talked about this, they have developed very differently in history because of falling mostly under this sphere of influence or this sphere of influence, right? And there, this is the, this line is actually our mountains, the Carpathian mountains. So you see why the separation is here. It's over the mountains, or this side of the mountain, central Washington versus eastern Washington, whatever. Right? Different cultures develop just because of the mountains. Right? So the same thing. Well, anyway, so because they failed to gain political objectives, to reach certain political objectives, the whole idea of, you know, well, actually, why not one Romania, and now, you know, you have the idea of Romania, which, again, notice the name, Roman, Romania, and so on, right? Is the whole, now, just like in the Czech parts and everywhere else, they start to standardize the language, move from Cyrillic to, which was a Slavic script, to a Latin script, just to emphasize the Latinity of the language, right? Because Romanian was written with Cyrillic scripts, right? Back to Cyril and Method, you know, but that was developed for the Slavic language. Now, the Romanian language has nothing to do with the Slavic language, or Romanian dialects have nothing to do with the Slavic language, and now, in order to move away from that Slavic, to clarify that this is a Latin language, they adopt the Latin script, right? Especially here. Okay, so all of this is going on in 18... I'm just pointing out here are those pictures I mentioned. In 1859, and this, you know, in 1859, these two principalities used the fact that the Ottomans were very weak and lost some wars, that the Austrians were busy with some wars, and the Russians were busy with other things, and they, both of these principalities separately elect the same prince. Now, remember, this was like the personal union of Poland and Lithuania. But the goal was here a sort of a national goal, right? So Moldova and Wallachia become one state, but it was called United Principalities. Again, not Romania, right? United Principalities, because they were principalities that were united by the same prince, native prince. Now, this prince will fail. There's always division between the nobles, division between the parties. They will actually then import a king from a well-established Western dynasty. And remember, why did you import a king or a monarch from somewhere else who was of German origin, who's never been to these lands, but agreed to be the king? And he will give the lineage of the Romanian kings. Is because always when you rooted yourself in an established dynasty, you rooted yourself in authority that was recognized throughout Europe. And that's what they will do. And with that king, these principalities will flourish. These principalities will flourish in the sense that they will keep their statehood, which was, you know, it was not sure that this would succeed, given how eager the other powers were to, you know, take over, think again, Poland, which was still, in the 19th century, did not exist. And in Transylvania, however, the Romanian speakers will, you'll have, remember, they will fare worse and worse in a sense. Because there, and they will ally themselves to the Habsburg partially, so they will be fond of the Habsburgs against the Hungarians. And against, why against the Hungarians? And this is a common thread, the Slovaks, the Croats, the Romanians, because of the policy of Magyarization. Because the Hungarians did build their statehood on this memory, this tradition, this reality of historical Hungary, but also infused it with the cultural content, unfortunately, as we talked about, in which, you know, they pushed quite aggressively and mindlessly, and the drink, you know, they're kind of reaping what they sowed in the 20th century. You will reap then the consequences of this, because they will create a memory of oppression in these lands, right? In these lands. And later on, when Romania will include Transylvania, you'll have a huge Hungarian minority in Transylvania, the reverse of the what used to be the situation, who will bear the brunt of the revenge of the formerly oppressed. Okay, so that's a brief survey. Let's move on to the Croatians. Now, as we talked about, the Croatians have been for almost 900 years at this point part of the Hungarian state, but with their own structures, and that was very important. Now, in the end of the 19th century, and this is key to understand both the situation in Croatia, the Croatian lands in Bosnia and in Serbia, what could the Croatians refer to, right? And one thing that they could refer to in terms of, okay, let's define nationhood and then claim political governance based on that, they could refer to the historic existence of this self-governance self, which meant the nobles, the nation of nobles, right? The historic existence of the diet that was Croatian, and the fact that they were never dissolved into other entities, but they always had their own self-rule. But again, self meant nobles, right? Note also, and remember that Croatia, there was not one Croatia, there were four lands, and the first kingdom that was formed was actually a triune kingdom, meaning that it was clearly pointing out the fact that there are three different lands, and historically, which have had different fates, right? So in Croatia you had, well, in what will later become Croatia, called Croatia, you had the royal Croatia, so sort of that part that was always had its own diet of nobles, and, you know, which the Habsburgs ruled through that diet. So royal Croatia. Then you have Dalmatia, which is on the coast, which was different. Then you had Slavonia, not Slovenia, right? And not Slovakia. Slavonia, royal Croatia, Dalmatia, and Istria. And Istria was, you know, again a different part. And they all had been, you know, Istria had been part of the Venice. Same with Slavonia, with Dalmatia, right? Not so long ago, right? And in the coast. So these were four different lands that they kind of tried to then put together. Oh, notice also, and remember that there was a significant number of what will later define themselves as Serbians, mostly because they were Eastern Orthodox, who moved from this part, from the Serbian part of the Ottoman Empire, as a result of Ottoman oppression, so to speak, or, you know, just bad conditions in the Ottoman Empire, economic, whatever. This was part of the Great Migration of the Serbs. That's very important because, so, a century before, Serbs moved away from Kosovo, so emptied Kosovo. So there was, remember, Kosovo had been the heart of Serbian culture and the church and whatever, but then they moved in the 18th century, and there's no Orthodox, Eastern Orthodox Slav in Kosovo, right, in that region here. Right? This will become very important later on. So they leave Kosovo during this great migration of the Serbs and settle in southern Hungary, in the Habsburg Empire, and at the borders of Croatia, and work. Basically, these villages become the border guards for the Austrian Empire, the Habsburg Empire. But they always kept their own identity, again, because of the church, because of the Eastern Orthodox Church that gave them sort of, which actually negotiated in their name. So their national identity, the only structure of institutions that they had that formed the backbone was the Orthodox Church. So these kinds of, you know, the Royal Croatian Slavonia had also about 20% of the population which were Eastern Orthodox. Most of the rest of the population here was Catholic. Now, why do I have problems with I'm just saying, well, these are Croatians, these are Serbians, isn't it clear? Well, no, because that's the point. Remember, these are all Slavic people speaking similar dialects of Slav. And it isn't so that, you know, at that point, you know, in all this area you have Slavs, right? Slavs of who speak three similar dialects. Right? So some of them here have lived in these areas, are mostly Catholic, but they have some Eastern Orthodox. Some of these here in what we call today Bosnia, right, remember, right, some will be Catholic, some will be Orthodox, some will be Muslim, because of that mass conversion to Islam, and also to the history of Bosnia, which had always a fragmented and weak religious identity, no coherence, not one identity. So you have three, you know, groups, religiously and so on, but they're all Slavs, right, only they have different regions and speak similar dialects. But again, there was never a case that this needed to be clarified. And then you have Slavs who were here, always Eastern Orthodox. Their historical memory goes to the Battle of Kosovo, losing the statehood of Serbia, and they have the Eastern Orthodox Church and whatever. But these are all, this is only one relatively small region, right? Relatively. Okay? So when the Croatian national, sort of revival starts, awakening, just like in the case of the Bohemians, who would define themselves as Czechs, they would have to clarify, okay, what does it mean to be Croatian? Because we have the name Croatia and everything, and actually the first movement of nationalistic movement was the Illyrian movement, which refers to the Illyria, which was the name of one of the Roman provinces here. And the reason why they didn't call themselves Croatians, because that was in the common parlance, people talked about Croatians, Serbians, as different, but the point is, here you have Eastern Orthodox, you have Muslims, you have Catholics who speak the same dialect or several dialects. You have Muslims who speak Štokavian, and Muslims, Slav Muslims who speak Kakavian. There were three dialects. Well, so are they different things? What are they? And these dialects are mutually comprehensible. Not the same with the Slovenes, by the way, which I'm not going to cover, which speak a significantly different Slavic dialect. So significant, so you can, it's clear that they're not. But here, so the Illyrian movement, in Croatia you'll have the clash of, firstly, there is an Illyrian movement which tries to basically say, artificially, you know, to define the Croatian language and Croatian identity as a sort of a southern Slav language. So they choose one of these dialects, create newspapers, spread them. Remember, if you're cultivated up to this point, you spoke German in the relations to authorities and so on, or Latin, you know, as was the case of one of the leaders of the national movement, who was a bishop, right, a Catholic bishop. They spoke Latin in church, right, and wrote in Latin and so on. So that when you start to define a different identity, say Croatian, you will have to, you know, okay, what does it mean to be Croatian? Are these Eastern Orthodox people who came from here? We know they came from here, but they speak the same language, or we share the two dialects. So which of, you know, what will be the separating part? Should it be one? Are all of these people actually one? Or are they several? I mean, this is all a matter of self-definition, because now it becomes important to define this. We have the historical, you know, memory, I mean, the historical reality of you know, there has been a Croatian system of administration and whatever, but then are these people not included? Are they the same as us? In fact, the Serbians speak, fewer Croatians spoke the dialect that Serbians speak, right? And it was mostly the peasants. The cultivated Croatians spoke a different dialect, very close ones, but different dialect, right? And the Illyrian school will choose that dialect, which was common for the common, which was spoken by a percentage of the common Croatians and most of the Serbians. You see that here is the trick was to kind of unite them through this common ground. Think again, English, right? Why are there Canadians and why are there Americans? Right? Again, and English. Right? They speak the same language, right? So, It's a similar, you know, that's the same thing, a similar dynamic, let me put it this way, okay? But in this case, language being the very tool through which we define nation, based on the German model, because remember, what was the German model? Germany never existed as a state. Now they want to form a state. They have to define who is German. And they try to force the Austrian in it. Why not? Right? Aren't they, don't they speak a very clearly German, a variation of German that is not very at all far from German. It's just, you know, certain things, minor things. And yet, they have a distinct identity as Austrians. Well, aren't the Austrians Germans? Well, aren't the Swiss German? Some of them speak German. Swiss speak four languages. What makes them Swiss? Right? So, you see how, you know, it's hard. This is difficult. So this fails. This fails because mostly because, well, Croatians didn't respond to this and Serbians didn't respond to this. Serbians didn't respond to this because meanwhile, what is going on in Serbia is that Serbia, as we'll talk in a second, Serbia is gaining independence from the Ottoman Empire. And it's very ambitious, as it has always been when it had statehood, right? And is Eastern Orthodox to the core and doesn't want to be considered to be to lump together. So this is a failed project. And then the other project was Yugoslavism, which ironically was invented by this Catholic bishop, Croatian bishop of German origin. who again wanted to bridge these difficulties and kind of create a Yugoslav identity. And Yugoslav means what? Yugo means southern, and then you have obviously Slav. So Yugoslav means the Slavs of the south. So you see that he's trying to create an identity that bridges the differences in dialect and in religion. And this is a Catholic bishop. Okay? But this also doesn't catch, because once they get, for example, Serbia gets its own statehood, it doesn't want to share this, to dissolve this into something broader. And this will be the drama of Yugoslavia. Because when it forms as the Kingdom of the Southern Slavs after 1918, it will still remain different peoples, and this will never be bridged. Because there is a commonality, but there are also differences. And no matter how you try to emphasize the commonality, the more you try to do that, the more the differences come out. And especially since each of these will be jealous of their own privileges and will try to impose a little bit preeminence from the Serbians, preeminence of the Croats, and so on. So you have, you know, the Illyrian movement fails. And the Štokavian language becomes the Croatian dialect. You know, just like in the case of the Bohemians, they needed to define the language. How do you define the language? By publishing in that language. While before, just 20 years before, you published in Latin or German or so on, now you publish in the native language. That standardizes, that creates, that imposes, and publishing newspapers, and creating the academies, and collecting folk culture, because you say, oh no, there's an identity that goes back into the people, because it's the people who we're talking about, who are the nation. Well, the people were never the nation in history. It was those who mattered politically who were the nation, right? In the ancient city-state of Athens, it was the citizens who were just a part of the whole thing, not all the people who lived in Athens. It was just a part of them who were the citizens. So you have that Yugoslavism that also fails, and again, hilariously invented here, hilarious for what will follow. And then you have the, you know, Croat-focused sort of nationalism associated with the party of right, not the right, party of right, which takes the view that, you know what, Croatia is whatever the territory used to be of Croatia, which never ceased to exist. You see, I've been telling you that, but actually that is a narrative that was invented again, brought about in the 19th century, the idea that the state has continued. It's true that self-administration has continued to various forms, but to say that the state has continued, you know, it's a narrative that you project backwards. Okay? So, you have, they will define, say, you know what, this has always existed in different forms that in voluntary association with the Hungarian crown, or then with the Habsburgs. Which means that everybody who is inside is Croatian. Which means everybody who is inside, whether they speak a dialect or the other, whether they're Orthodox or Catholic or whatever, they're Croatian. Now, these people here on the west side, on the east side, who were those who immigrated 150 years ago as, you know, Serbians, Eastern Orthodox, and kind of kept that identity because of their distinct religious situation and because of the distinct relationship with the Habsburgs, they said, no, what are you trying to make us Croatian? Yeah. You see how a political definition of Croatian, which you would say, okay, that should solve the problem, is actually clashes with, you know, the way these people have defined their identity and have rediscovered their identity. Plus, they had now a Serbia here to which they could refer and say, no, we're part of this Serbia. We're not part of Croatia. And we're writing, so to speak, 1850s. And that will be the same thing that will lead to the wars of 1990s. The same debate in a way, as you will see. And in between, that's Croatia. In between, and we've talked about the fact that they will turn against the Hungarians in 1848. I'm not going to go further into this, and you know, you have to read the chapters. And in between, that's what we call Bosnia and Herzegovina, which were two different lands, by the way, always. Bosnia and Herzegovina. Right? It's a very good map of the Austrian Empire, Austro-Hungarian Empire. In Bosnia, you have this other tragic situation, right? Of a land that has had self-administration, so a political identity within the Ottoman Empire as a sort of a region, province, distinct with its own. But in terms of identity, what you had for centuries, you were Slavs who spoke kind of the same dialect, but some were Catholic, some were Orthodox, and some were Muslim. And that was the major difference. But there's an additional problem here, because in the Ottoman Empire, as we discussed, it was mostly Ottomans mostly Muslims who could own land and who could be nobles. So, which meant that most of the peasants, most of the Christians were peasants. There were some Christians who were landlords, yes, and there were actually more Muslims were peasants than nobles, of course. So it was always a pyramid, right? But if you put it that way, among the nobles, there was a larger percentage of nobles who were Muslim. While among the peasants, they were both. But because the feudal situation in the Ottoman Empire and in the Bosnian lands was so dire, and the situation of the peasants, because of the stagnation of the Ottoman Empire and the lack of reforms, was so dire, there is a continued clash between these landlords, between landowners, and the peasants. Peasants who are both Muslim and Christian. But most of the landlords or landowners are Muslim. And this social tension that results, just like in other lands around here, by the way, the Romanian, Transylvania, there were huge peasant uprisings, very bloody, and crushed equally bloodily everywhere. But here, notice that it becomes a sort of we're revolting against the nobles, but most of them are Muslims, so it's basically the Muslims oppressing us. Well, you know, untrue in the sense that peasants were equally both, you know, Christians and Muslims, and all of them actually rose together against the nobles. That was their problem, you know, the serfs against the nobles. But when the crushing of the revolution, when the revolt happens, which is always bloody and really brutal, you know, what you'll hear is that the Muslim landowners, although some of them were Christian, but the Muslim landowners have crushed the Christian peasants, and also the Muslims. But the Christian peasants and the Serbians here will say, wait a minute, but the Christian peasants here, who, let's say, are Orthodox, these are Serbians. So we have the Bosniaks, this new identity of Bosniak, which is simply the Slavs who speak, who are Muslim, but again, didn't exist, it was just Slavs by three religions. Well, these Muslims are oppressing our fellow Serbians. How do I know they're fellow Serbians? Because they're Orthodox and Slavs. So let's go in, and when Serbia will form its own state, it will go into Bosnia and, guess what? Do some genocide, some ethnic cleansing. The words didn't exist then. But this is one of the, you know, more recent examples of ethnic cleansing, because that's what happened. Serbian troops enter into Bosnia, or groups rather, armed groups, or troops, that's a big word, and target Muslims, not Muslim nobles, and erase Muslim villages. So the whole thing from a social conflict between peasants who were Muslim and Christian against nobles, which were mostly Muslim, but it was a social conflict, becomes an ethnic conflict, but ethnic divided not by language, because they speak literally the same dialects of Slavic, and in this case actually the same, most of them, but which becomes divided by religion. So if, you know, in the United States, nationality was defined politically because we want to have a different system of government than the British Crown. It was language. Language was the same. So what reason can you bring? It was a political reason. We want a different form of government. If in France it was, well, political because whoever is within the state is French, willy-nilly. If in Hungary and Transylvania it is linguistic because it's clear that Hungarian is not Romanian, it's not German. These are very different language groups. Here, you can't use language to define nationhood. Here it will become, because the dialects are so close, it will become religion. But again, notice that religion as such doesn't have a play here. The main proponent of Yugoslavism, of Illyria, was a Croatian Catholic bishop of Germanic origin who spoke Latin in church. Okay? So it wasn't religion as such, because religion is, it was the fact that nationhood was defined. Because this was the only criteria to which you could separate these things. There has been different geography, right? And different local cultures. But within these different local cultures here, within this geography of historical Croatia, remember when the Croatians said, everybody who's in is Croatian, the Eastern Orthodox who migrated there from Serbia or Serbian lands said, no, I don't want to be Croatian. So they tried to use the political way of defining nationhood, and it couldn't work. They tried to use the language, but it doesn't cannot work because some of these dialects, you know, many Serbians and a good proportion of Croatians spoke Štokavian dialect of Slavic, and so then who is Croatian, who is Serbian? The only remaining division that corresponds also with the kind of the physical different lands here and their different historical experience became religion. Except for Bosnia, unfortunately, again and again in history, which found itself, these lands, Bosnia and Herzegovina, divided between populations who suddenly had to define themselves as other things, although until now they were Slavs who were either Christian or Muslim, or Eastern Orthodox or Muslim, or Western Catholic. Orthodox, Muslim, or Catholic. So what happens in Bosnia, and I moved to Bosnia, right, clearly, what happens now in Bosnia in the 19th century is that everybody who was Catholic in these lands now becomes Croat, although some of them have been Hungarian originally or German, but whatever, whoever is Catholic now is associated with Croatian, whoever is Orthodox, or maybe they have been Vlachs, the Vlachs didn't have their own state, that's a different tribe population that lived in that area, not Slavic, and, or, you know, older, like Thracians, going back to the Thracians. They become associated with the Serbians, and who's left are the Slavs who were Muslim, and they shall be called Bosniaks. Of course, it didn't matter until now, but now it matters because whoever is the people can claim statehood. And guess what? Both Serbia and when Croatia will, you know, try to form as a, you know, it will remain within the Habsburg Empire until 1918, but the more it tries to shape its statehood, they will both claim these parts of Bosnia, because they were claiming all their Croatians here, all their Serbians here. Guess what? That's exactly what will happen during the wars of Yugoslavia in the 1990s. And now you will have, you'll understand that one of the greatest tragedies of European history of the recent time, the greatest tragedies of World War II, has roots in the birth of the modern state, has roots in modern nation building. It's almost an inescapable result of this model of the modern state associated with a nation, of actually the idea that a people needs to govern itself, but who is that people? Right? All these democratic notions are just a grenade thrown into a reality that has never been that simple. What language you spoke never really mattered politically. But we want democracy. People should run themselves. But which people? Well, all of them together. Really? Again, why not Mexico together with the United States? And Canada. Oh, that's absurd. Why not remain within the British Empire? Oh, that's absurd. You see how, you know, this makes sense because we have this country and all the countries have experienced this process, have gone through this process. Right? Was it necessary? Well, it's an interesting question, right? Was it necessary to form the modern state? Well, in many ways, you want progress, you want reform, you want to implement reforms, you need a strong state, so it seems to be necessary. You want democracy, you need the people to govern itself, and you're back there. This is, you know, in many ways, the tragedy. A tragedy that still goes on in Africa and whatever, where again, we talked about this fact, those are inventions, those borders. Literally inventions. Not even figuratively, literally inventions. They simply are reaches as far as the colonial powers could reach. And I will stop now. The first part of the video will continue with a shorter second part.